Diego Garcia online with us. Somehow this person has the correct naming. Hello, Diego Garcia. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
It is Carl Boyle presenting now, and I will let him present himself and go ahead with the presentation. Stage is yours, Carl.
Okay, thank you. I hope you can all hear me well. I guess, yes, okay. Thank you for inviting me for the Dimensions in XR. I will talk about virtuality and education and focus on what's to learn. So indeed, my name is Carl Boel. I'm a researcher at the Thomas More University of Applied Sciences, where I focus on virtuality in training, virtuality in education, and we are also into a research track on virtual collaboration tools and meeting tools, especially during the COVID period. It's really necessary, and we are doing a business track on it. I'm also a researcher, a PhD researcher at Ghent University, where I focus on the immersive virtual reality in secondary education. Apart from that, I have my own company called Virtual Learning is Reality, where I am a consultant using evidence-informed instructional design for XR experiences. And I give workshops to teachers and students on how they can implement virtual reality in their secondary education classes. Now, it's important to make sure none of the pictures I have used are my own property, so they are only used for illustrative reasons. So let's first focus on why VR in education. Well, first we see there's a shift from the industry towards this industry 4.0, where we see all these new innovative technologies such as IoT, machine learning, virtual reality, augmented reality, mixed reality. And these are at this moment being used in the industry, and the industry calls for well-trained students. And therefore, I think it's important to make them acquainted with these tools already in education, and they can be implemented and used in an interesting way in education too. Now, this is actually the moment you could start with VR. Probably most of because of this man, Mark Zuckerberg, who invested huge amounts of money in the advancements, the technological advancement of virtual reality headsets. And thank God, because otherwise this would have been the way to experience virtual reality. Although it started like this. Gladly, we evolved big time, and now we already have these kind of devices which are standalone and are really easy to use in classrooms. Now, you can also see that in the investments, we see that there is a lot of growth in the investments. Some even speak of a raise of 59%. Others speak of 27%. Even ABI research says they will spend on VR in education like 640 billion. I'm not sure whether these numbers are correct, but we can really see that there is a growing interest in VR in education. You see also that there are firms specialized in developing for education, such as ClassVR by Aventis and Immersify, to name only two. But this is really interesting to see that they are really specializing in these things. You see also that there are companies which are dedicated in providing a 360 approach on VR, in including their own headsets, such as ClassVR, but also Victory XR, for example, and the Lenovo Classroom, they all provide the users with not only the devices, but also the content, which is curriculum aligned. They provide training and so on. So you see really growing interest and investment and shift towards VR and education. So this is the momentum to be working on it. Now, before I'll talk about what we already know, it's important to understand what we're talking about. Because you cannot just say VR, because it's more than that. Virtual reality is not just virtual reality. There are different types of VR. In this talk, I will talk about immersive VR, but you see, this is the continuum by Milgram and Kishino. At the left end, you have the real environment. On the right, you have the virtual environment. But even within VR, there is a difference between non-immersive or semi-immersive VR and immersive VR. Now, why is that important? Well, if you look in the literature, you can see all kinds of papers. But to name, I just took two of them. This one talks about effectiveness. So there were good learning outcomes. They were effective in improving learning, but it was desktop-based virtual reality. If you compare that with this paper, it says less learning, and it was about immersive virtual reality. And you see that students learning in immersive learned less. So it's really important to understand which VR you're talking about, because they ask for a completely different approach. Now, what is so great about VR? It's this. You see, what's happening is that people do really strange things. People act really strange when they have a VR headset on. And why is that? That's because they really think your brain really thinks you are there. It's the feeling of being there. And that's an important one, because that is what makes this technology so unique. Now, when talking about being there, there is a lot of discussion between which label you should use. And there are always two labels used, immersion versus presence. And I'll tell you what the difference is and how I'm going to use it, because it's important to understand. Immersion is sometimes called the involvement in the play which causes the lack of awareness of time. But when you read the definition by Draper and colleagues, they talk about presence as a mental state in which a user feels physically present. So when you watch the definitions, they both mean the same, being there. But they call it immersion versus presence. So what is actually, in my opinion, the most correct one? It's the definition that Southgate and colleagues gave. The feeling of being there is about that's presence. It's a subjective experience, the sense of being there in the environment. This comes forth from the flow theory by Nakamura and his colleague, which name I'm not even going to try to pronounce. But the flow theory is about losing yourself, losing your self-conscious, and forgetting about time, because you're so involved in the act of the virtual environment. So this flow one is experiencing is very similar to what we are calling presence in immersive virtual reality. On the other hand, you have immersion, and Slater and Wilbur defined immersion as an objective and quantifiable description of what a system does provide. So immersion is the technical features a device provides to create the sense of presence. But this is really a difference, because the immersion is about the technical properties of the device and how it's made. And the presence is what's the result of the amount of immersion. So it's important to make that distinction, because, for example, immersion is about the way of the amount of interactivity. It's the amount of representational fidelity, the degree of realism. It's about haptics. It's about the media richness. It's about the usability of the system. So these are all technical properties. Now, what's the relation between them? Well, this is the flow you should consider. When there's an immersive device, it can provide for presence, and we know that presence leads to the outcomes we want. So this is the flow of an immersive experience, whether it be learning or else, but this is the general immersive virtual reality flow. This is the conceptual framework by Matt Bauer. And you see on the left, you see stimulus, which you can actually call immersion. The organism is our reaction to it. And yes, you can see at top cognitive reaction, it's called immersion, but he saw immersion as actually the mental state. So we should forget about that. But the organism is our reaction. That's the feeling we get from the immersion. And then the outcomes is what's the outcome of the immersion? The outcome of the presence resulting from the immersion. So now we know what we're talking about. Let's dive into what we already know and what we should figure out still. I did, as is the usual case, I did a review study on what we already know in secondary education concerning immersive virtual reality, and I only focused on the empirical research because in my research, I'm really interested in how is it in a classroom. We can talk about theory and we can talk about laboratory experiments, but it's more important to focus on what's happening in the classroom. So I focused on empirical research. I saw a growing number of studies on immersive virtual reality, which is great because you see the same growth of interest in market and in science. So these are accompanying each other. Next, you also see that it's not only in entertainment, but you see also a growing interest in education. So you see that this technology is being adopted, let's be honest, at this moment, fairly experimental, but it's being adopted and it's being experimented with. What do we know? We see that in which subject area virtual reality is being used. This is immersive virtual reality in general education. And you see, which is not surprising, the majority is in computer science, engineering, medicine, and social sciences. I'll come to that later. When we focus on higher education, you see, again, engineering, science, and health as being the main domains. And in my own research, I saw a very huge amount of studies in STEM-related topics, apart from all the other topics, which I can understand because also STEM is at this moment high on the political agenda. But I think we should also take into account other topics. So, as is typical, again, for research, when you want to study a new technology, you have not yet a lot of insights on. You should first focus on how is it being looked at. And then we did some interviews to investigate the acceptance of immersive virtual reality in secondary education. And we interviewed not only teachers, but all the other persons which are involved in the classroom implementation of technology. So we also interviewed the IT staff, we interviewed principals, and we interviewed teachers trainers, because they have an important influence on the actual implementation too. Okay, we used the UTOT as the UTOT 2 as a framework. UTOT stands for the Unified Theory of Acceptance and Use of Technology. In Maria, in the previous talk, used the TAM. We preferred the UTOT because we think that, especially with VR, there are a lot of factors which are extra and which were not in the original TAM model, such as the price value, the habit, and especially the hedonic motivation. So we used the UTOT as a framework to interview these people. The first thing, sorry, I have to go back. The first thing we are always interested in, and teachers are always interested in, is the performance expectancy. Will it be effective? How can I use it in my classroom? And this has to do with what we call the affordances. Affordances are opportunities you can use with the technology. And you see that it's interesting that on the left hand, you see the immersion and the presence, which are technological affordances, which create educational affordances, to name only empathy and embodiment, but there are more, and I'll dive into it right away. Now, these affordances should be interpreted in the affordance theory model by Gibson, which says that affordances are opportunities. When you see something, you use it likewise. For example, when you see a chair, people know, oh yeah, it's to sit on. When there's a door, it's to open it and to close it. So affordances are what you can do with this item, and there it should be viewed in a broad way, because affordances, this is the framework by I just forgot, I'll tell you later, in where you see the e-learning sorry,
Gibson, isn't it?
No, I don't think this one is by Gibson. Let me check. It's by Bauer. So the affordance theory itself is by Gibson, indeed, but Bauer focused on the e-learning affordances itself. And you see that there are a lot of ways to interpret e-learning affordances. So it's important to understand that you can see it in a broad way, and you'll see later on that I did it also. So let's focus first on the positive outcomes, the positive affordances, about functionality, about usefulness. And the first one, if you look at apps like Google Earth, like Google Expeditions, Arts and Culture, Boulevard, Tides of Space, Rome Reborn, it's all about Discovery VR. They all create opportunities, affordances, which are not possible any way other. Any other way, sorry, because they transport the user to distant places and to distant times you cannot do in any other way, which is great. This is one of the most noted affordances by teachers themselves. They see these opportunities as one of the best. But another one is to be able to explore and to investigate, to explain. You can dive into your own body. You can dive into the chemical structure of a cell. You can visualize difficult math problems. You can dissect the body, or you even wonderful you, you can experience how it was as a baby in the womb of your mother. This is something which is unimaginable before, but now with virtual reality, especially with immersive virtual reality, it's all possible. And again, this is a great example of how you can augment the way to explore and to explain. A third affordance is to train. You can train your public speaking skills, you can train conversational skills, soft skills, you can train hard skills such as the engine, fire safety, you can safely operate a chemical laboratory, you can work at height, you can train on your first aid skills. I created my own VR application called Verkeer, which helps children to ride a bicycle safely in traffic, and they can drive their virtual bike in traffic, and they can experience all these kinds of incidents, and they know what happens. So this is can all be done in a safe way with unlimited possibilities. So immersive VR is great for practicing and for training. Another great approach for immersive virtual reality is to create awareness. For example, you see the ocean set, Stanford's ocean acidification, you see clouds of cyanide in which you enter a refugee camp. You see we wait where refugees take the trip over the Middle Sea, and the party in which you experience how it is to be a person with autism at a birthday party. You experience what racism is about, and you see all these apps which are freely available on both the high-end device but also on your smartphone, and you can experience and create awareness and understanding. You can create empathy in a way which is really powerful, because you experience it from first hand through your own eyes. It's also about meeting. It's about collaborating. It's about discussing. You see all these apps like Spatial, the Vive XR suit, Engage. You can also collaborative create and design things within the same environment at the same time without any limitations whatsoever. So again, this is great. As you can share, you can discuss, you can collaborate, and it's important. I'll come to that later. The Bloom's high order thinking skills of creating is also possible. You have tilt brush, king spray, paint. You can create a VR sketch. The co-spaces in which you can, which students can create their own AR and VR, and so on. So it's great to create, to design, and to present your own materials, what you came up with. So to summarize, there are a lot of virtual reality learning affordances from a student's perspective. I made a list of them here. It's what Kavanaugh and others call applications. I think it's kind of a strange name, but it's actually the affordances you can create for your student. But we have to be cautious, because we're all enthusiastic about these. And yes, they are possible, but we do not yet know whether they are really effective. Maybe you have seen this study by PricewaterhouseCoopers, in which they said, yeah, it's four times faster to train. People are more confident, they are more emotionally connected, and they are more focused. These are really high promises, but actually, unfortunately, and I really mean this, unfortunately, the study is kind of worthless, because they did it in a completely improper way. And not I am saying that, but two experienced learning experts and research experts, Miriam Nehl and Paul Kirchner, studied the VR study by PricewaterhouseCoopers using the Goddard sieve, and they came up with this outcome. And it's just said that the report is completely done in an improper way, unfortunately, and I really mean it. But it's a missed chance, because they could have proven the effectiveness of virtual reality. And that's something which we should be honest about. I'm not a VR enthusiast, I'm a VR realist, because I think we should be realistic about what we already know about VR, and there's a lot to be discovered yet. So let's be honest about it, because when you watch actual research, you see that there is less learning, because we really have to take a learner-centered approach and not a technology-centered approach. So we should not be too enthusiastic about that technology, but think about how it can be used for learning. How can we foster learning? And we should foster the affordances by using sound instructional design principles. Actually, this is something we already know for over 20 years, because we should be aware that it's not the media itself which will influence learning. It's what teachers do with the technology and how they implement it into their classrooms and their classes. That is what makes learning. So to go back to this UTOT, there are opportunities, but we are not yet sure about the effectiveness of it. Another concern a lot of teachers said was that, you know, how does it fit in my pedagogy? And it's something which already was mentioned in 2015. It was not yet immersive VR, but it was desktop VR, but it's what is how does it fit in a pedagogical framework? And it's a great question, and we can right now answer that in a proper way. This was the proposal by Dalgarno and Lee, who came up with the affordances and how they interrelate with each other. But then we have to broaden it and make it fit into pedagogical frameworks we already know. And so it's interesting to use the revised framework by Bloom, because that's a framework which pretty much covers all kinds of learning activities we make use of. I also wanted to integrate the SAMR framework, because I think it's an interesting framework to think about. And in combining these two, I think we can answer the question by Fowler. So here you see a combination of all these frameworks. You see on the left hand, you see Bloom with the different thinking skills. On the right hand, you see SAMR. And if you want to use VR for just remembering, I think we should be honest, VR is not your solution for your learning goal. It's way too expensive. It takes too much effort. So you should use something else. It would be merely a substitution. And that's something which I saw already too much, being it's a kind of edutainment, an add-on, but it's just substitution without any added value. And that's what VR should be. It should be an added value. But it can be used, interestingly, to understand things such as body VR, tides of space, Rome Reborn. You can go to places you can normally not visit and experience yourself, and you can understand how things interrelate. Also with applying, and especially from here, you see also on the right, you see modification and redefinition. Now it becomes really interesting, because it's learning by doing, which is so powerful for learning. It's not the passive consuming, but it's the actual doing and experimenting and analyzing, creating, evaluating. These are the thinking skills we should focus on because they bring us further in the end. So if you ask yourself, where's the pedagogy? Well, I don't think it's a question anymore. Here is your pedagogy because you can use immersive virtual reality for a unique set of affordances which are not possible in any other way. And they make things possible in the summer model. They make things possible which are not possible any other way, especially for the higher order thinking skills. And this is really great. So these are the things we should focus on, and we can do it in a pedagogical framework. Next to this, we can also, apart from the constructivist theory of learning by doing and collaborative learning, we can also see a lot of other affordances for teachers. They said the value of them for them is also the add-on of gamification and game-based learning, but they also saw increased motivation, enjoyment. You can use it for personalized learning and for deeper learning. So this is what Kavanaugh calls motivations. It's also interesting to see that immersive virtual reality can provides for a more enormous amount of learning analytics, which we can use wisely in dashboards to understand and to keep track of the individual's individual students' progress. But of course, there are also all kinds of barriers. And as I said before, in the previous talk of Maria on AR, we see some resemblances. But especially for VR, there are some ethical use issues because you cannot use it under the age of 13. They are sometimes encountered with violence, which is important. Is you should create a safe and respectful environment. Some students experience motion sickness. And this is something which I found great, is Southgate and her colleagues created in collaboration with the teachers themselves, some instructions to create a safe environment, and which is important because, and this is the result of in-class research, and this is something we should do a lot more. All kinds of other technical issues, such as the hardware, lack of training or the cost of training and support, network issues, Wi-Fi infrastructure, for example, usability, it blocks, for example. Organization, we do not have content which is ready off the shelf. Sometimes it's just edutainment, as I said before. Students should get familiarized with them, and it takes time. We have to use a specific room for it. There should be someone surveying the students. Sometimes it's multiple user accounts, and it's difficult to manage, and so on and so on. Also, you see that not everyone is that engaged. You see also a gender effect in that young girls do not like virtual reality very much. And the ones who have already experience in VR or in gaming experience, they progress way faster. Sometimes they also fear of being looked at, and they do not like it. And this is a specific issue, the cognitive overload. But then we should focus on the evidence-informed instructional design we already know, such as the principles by Mayer and Clark, for example. So the plea actually from all this research is that we should go from the theoretical frameworks in the laboratory settings towards the in-class, the natural environment of the classroom to especially find out what really works. And you see all these kinds of limitations you see in the studies. They are all focused on laboratory experiments in controlled settings or in higher education or in adult training. So we should do it in the natural setting. Important to understand, there's a lot of opportunities and affordances of virtual reality, but we should be realistic about it. There's still a lot to be discovered. There's a lot to be investigated, and we should understand that VR is just a tool. It's not a magic wand you can work with. So this was my talk. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions, please feel free to reach out. But I think there are there's some time left right now, I think.
Thank you very much, Carl. It was a great presentation. Thank you for this. And it pointed out to a lot of realities about the potential of VR, but mm-hmm. also the limitations that come along, including lack of content, lack of expertise in the young ages, difficulties with children below the age of 13. All of this I can totally relate when I try to do more research with virtual reality myself. I will open it up for questions. We have almost 20 minutes. If anyone has any questions, otherwise, I will go ahead and ask a couple of questions.